Father God, for the soldiers that are on the battlefield for you, Father. We pray right now, Father, in the name of Jesus, that you will speak, Lord. Give us a word that will bring new life. Give us a revelation, Father. Give us edification, Father, in the name of Jesus. I pray right now, Father God, let me decrease so that you can increase. Close my mouth and open yours. Let me sit in you so you can stand in me. We pray, Father God, you would touch every soul that's breathing here tonight. And those that refuse to be touched, you touch them in a way and show them that you are God. And we thank you right now, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on, give God another hand. And thank you, praise. We're going to look at our foundational scripture tonight. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 10. Hallelujah. Then while you turn in there, put a finger on Genesis 6. Genesis 6. Could you please stand for the reading of the word? Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And then Genesis chapter 6. We have to say amen. Verse 10, according to the grace of God that which have been given to me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation and another one builds on it. But let each one take heed to how he builds on it. For no other foundation can a man lay than that which is already laid, and that's Jesus Christ. Genesis 6. Verse 13. Genesis 6, verse 13 is where I want to park my car tonight. Genesis 6, we have to say amen. Amen. Verse 13, and God said to Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me. For the earth is filled with violence through them. And behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Here it is. Make yourself, or build yourself, an ark of gopher wood. Make rooms in the ark and cover it inside and outside with pitch. And this is how you shall make it. This is how you shall build it. The length of the ark shall be 300 cubits and its width 50 cubits and its height 30 cubits. Verse 16, you shall make a window for the ark. You shall finish it to a cubit from above and set a door of the ark in his side, and you shall make it with a lower, second, and third decks. Go down to verse 20. Of all the birds after their kind, of the animals after their kind, and of every creeping thing of the earth after its kind, of every kind will come to you on the ark just to keep them alive. Amen. I want to preach tonight as spiritually to guide us from this thought we have in our mind. This time, I'm going to build it the right way. This time, I'm going to build it the right way. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor,
this time,
I'm going to build it the right way. If you believe it, come on, give God praise tonight. I believe in his prophets. God is going to give me instructions on how to build it the right way. When we go back home, God is going to give us basic instructions on how to build it the right way. Come on, give God praise tonight. For the anointing in this house that God's going to give us, that we be able to build it the right way. You may be seated in the house of the Lord. I'm reminded of a story about this elderly guy who was a carpenter. He spent 35 years with this company. And he got ready to retire. And he told his owner, he said, listen, after 35 years of working with this company, I'm ready to retire. He said, I want to go home and spend time with my family. Being that he was the best carpenter on the job, the owner said, listen, before you leave, can you at least build one more house? I know you're ready to retire. I know you're getting ready to go. Listen, you are the best that we have. Before you leave, can you at least build us one more house? He agreed and he said, yes, I can build you one more house. But instead of him building it from the ground, his heart wasn't in it, but his hand was on it. And the
because his heart wasn't in it, he got an old house that was already demolished and tried to reconstruct it. He got wood that was shabbish. He went hiring the cheapest contractors that he could find. The electricity was faulty. The wires were faulty. He did a cheap and faulty job because his heart wasn't in it. As soon as he got back, he said, listen, boss man, I'm finished building the last house. Out of all the houses that he built, why do a cheap job on your last house? Called him over. Closed doors, the wires was messed up. Behind closed doors, the wood was messed up. Behind closed doors, the foundation was messed up. But because he wanted to rush the house, and he was getting ready to leave the job, he rushed his last assignment. The owner came back. He said, man, you did a wonderful job. He said, here it is. Here's keys to your house. We couldn't give you much because you were getting ready to retire. So for our gift to you, you just built your own house. Oh, what a shame and a shock. If he had known it was for him, job. If he had known that was his house, he would still be building on it. If he had known it was for him, he would have got expensive labor. But because he thought it was somebody else's house, he rushed it. And God said, in this season, work it like it's your own house. Build it like it's your own house. Serve like it's your own house. Clean up like it's your own house. Like it's your own house, because God said, whatever you make happen in my house, I'll make happen in your house. If you take care of my house, God said, I'll take care of your house. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, this time you're gonna build it right. This time we're gonna build it right. This time we're gonna do the right thing. This time, if God ever put some stuff in my hand, I'm gonna do it right. Old song says, serve the Lord, we'll pay out. After a while, here in Genesis, God, he made a statement. He was mad that he never made man because of the sin of the world. God was mad that he never made man. But God found grace and favor. He found favor in a man who called his name Noah. He brought Noah. He said, Noah, I need you to do something for me. I'm getting ready to destroy all mankind. Here it is. He said, Noah, I need you to retire from being a farmer. What you've been doing has been good, but I need you to retire from being a farmer to becoming a builder. I know you don't have experience in building, but I'm getting ready to put an anointing on you for building. I'm talking to somebody here today. You don't have the background. You don't have the training. You don't have the education. But God said there is an anointing on your life to build. I know what you've been doing 20 years ago, but get ready for a career change. Get ready for God to make you a builder. When God makes you a builder, God put the Holy Ghost on you. And the anointing enables you to do what you can't do in the flesh. I'm talking to somebody that you never encourage somebody and the spirit of counsel hits you and you start saying some good stuff. You say, God, that was for me too. So I'm going to make you a builder. Noah spent all of his time farming because his dad farmed. But what I'm getting ready to call you to do is something that's going to be different from your bloodline. I'm getting ready to call you to build. Here it is. So Noah, I'm calling you not because of your educational background. I'm calling you not because you build houses your whole life. I'm calling you because I know if you do it, you're going to build it the right way. So But what you're going to build is going to save a whole nation. What you're going to build, Noah, listen, they don't even know it. What you're going to build, Noah, will save your household. I'm talking to somebody, some of the hardest people to save are those who live with you. Some of the hardest people to save are those who have your last name. But God said, that's the reason why you have to come to this conference tonight. Because some of you have children that have misled the gospel. But God said, that is an anointing on your life that will save your household. I'm talking about that daughter who messing up. God said, keep on preaching and keep on building. You will save your household. I'm quite sure Noah can begin to celebrate God because my sons are on the ark. Their wives are on the ark. That is an anointing on your life that will save not your neighbor, but will save your own son. Your own family. I know they don't respect you now, but when they see what you built, they realize you didn't tell me daddy could do something like this, mama could do something like this. There it is. So, Noah, I want you to do something. Here it is. He said, verse 14. He said, Noah, I'm going to tell you what to be. I'm going to tell you how to build it. And I'm going to tell you what to build it with. Tell you, watch this. In order for us to be a master builder and build it right, we must have instruction from the Lord. He said, no, don't get it twisted. Build me an ark. I read many translations, and they all said, build. But I read one translation, and it said something different. It said, Noah, build a boat. Something wrong with this. Why? Because there is a difference, here it is, between a boat and an ark. So now listen, Noah, you got to read, Noah. Why? Because there is a big difference between a boat and an ark. Is a large vessel used for traveling. A boat is a large vessel used for traveling. A boat has a sail on it. Then when the wind blows, it will push the boat in the opposite direction. But he said, Noah, I don't want you to build a boat. I need you to build an ark. Well, what is an ark, Apostle? An ark is a large vessel used for floating. Send a flood water. I'm getting ready to send a storm. And if you build a boat, you won't make it. If you build a boat, you will sink. And some of us, the reason why our ministry don't make it, because we spent 25 years building the wrong thing. We spent 25 years building a boat, trying to look pretty and trying to impress other people. But God said in this season, don't build a boat. I need you to build an ark. And I'm talking to somebody here today. You know you got an ark because 2018 was rough for you. And your testimony is, I'm floating. After people left me, I learned how to float. Offers went down, but I'm floating. People stabbed me in the back, but I'm floating. People left me for dead, but I'm floating. Do I have any floaters in here? And you are good. You should have sunk, you should have tripped over, but thank you to God, I didn't go a boat. Thank you, Jesus, I put it locked. I'm building some stuff that know how to float through danger, sin, and honesty. Look at somebody, say, neighbor, I'm floating. I'm floating. God told me to help you. He said, listen, I allow that storm to hit your church last year. Allow the storm here to hit your ministry last year. here to expose to the community. You didn't have a boat, you had an ark. And some of you got people who left you in the back of your mind. How am I going to make it without so-and-so? God said, if you build an ark, you'll float in the way. I'm talking to some of you in the day. I said, praise and worship to the left, but you got CDs and tracks, and you put it in the CD player, and you learn how to flow on.
Floating and not being strong, but you are strong.
floating means being strong when you're weak. How many of you can be strong when you are weak? So you really, really, really have to preach until you preach when you were weak. You really, really have to sing a song until you sung when you were weak. You really have to deep until you deep when you were weak. You really have to cook fried chicken after church until you cook fried chicken when you were weak. You really haven't done anything until you've done it. But that's what the Holy Ghost for. That's what the anointing for. And some of you need to get rebaptized in the Holy Ghost, because Paul said, when I was weak, that's when I became strong. He said, build an ark. I'm build a boat. I need you to build something that can float. If you build it right, build something that has the capacity to float in difficult times. He said, I'm telling you what to use. He said, build it out of gopher wood. I'm going to look at me cross-eyed. But look with glasses on. That's all right. He said, I'm going to build it out of gopher wood. Listen, out of the 39 books in the Old Testament, the 27 in the New Testament, the only place you will find gopher wood is Genesis 6:14. You won't find it in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. You won't find it in Malachi. You won't find it in Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. You won't find it nowhere. But in Genesis 6, 14, he said, you won't find this nowhere in the Bible. God mentioned gopher wood one time. He didn't mention gopher wood one time. Noah is getting ready to build. But God, the wood you asked me to use, I can't find it anywhere. You asked me to build, and that's fine. You want me to build an ark, and I'm fine with that. But God, my problem is, what? You asked me to use. Okay. Sing. To find it. Because gopher wood is rare. It's rare. And it's hard to replace. Replace. It took Noah 100 years to build an ark. 100 years to build his ark. Listen, what God promised Noah didn't happen till 100 years later. What? We cried after 6 months. We cried after 2 years. And what God promised Noah didn't happen till later. So I inboxed Noah. I said, Noah, what took you so long? I mean, I went Facebook Live. He said, I'm in heaven enjoying myself. Why are you interrupting me? I said, Noah, please leave the angels alone. I got one question for you. Why did it took you so long to build an ark? Noah replied was, it took me so long to build an ark because I spent half of my life trying to find my help. I spent half of my life trying to find, because guess what? I couldn't use cedar wood. I couldn't use pine wood. I couldn't use ash wood. I could only use gopher wood. And your problem is, you're too quick to build. You can use anything and everything. You can build the first thing I can find. And that's the reason why the church don't last, because you didn't use what God wanted. go for one. Why? Because when people leave, they can't find nobody. See, that explains the reason why the people who left you joined 8 other churches and still not satisfied.
That's one of the reasons why God wants
again.
Help us. Help us.
You find out, watch this. God's reward was waterproof. Outside of the ark. He relates the outside. Then he lays the inside. Why? Because sometimes your greatest attacks. Some of us, our greatest attacks didn't come from what I was y'all. Some of our greatest attacks came from the people on the ark with us.
Come down, slow down. Take some of those windows back.
his son's behind him, and his wife behind him. He's looking. They got to get him out of the way so they can see. And she got away. So the son can see. The son's got to be. So the wife can see. The wife's got to be. So the horse can see. The horse's got to be. So the giraffe can see.
Hard to find. You took time to find what you need to build ministry with.
Come on now.
So then when you got it, before you even put it in position, you anointed it first. You made sure it was covered.
All right now.
Not just outside, but you made sure it was covered outside and inside. When you look at the hedge that Job had around him, Satan went to and fro seeking whom he may devour. He said, I'm trying to get him, but you had a hedge around him. Not just here it is, around him, but around him. That particular hedge that Job had around him, it had thorns all the way around. So if the enemy tried to come into Job's life, he'll get pricked. But if Job had to leave God, he'll get pricked. So the hedge, when God covers you on the inside and outside, he covers you on the outside to make sure nothing penetrates your life. But when he covers you on the inside, he makes sure the stuff I put in there don't leave out. That explains why you lost everything but your joy. You went through everything but your key. Putting all your hopes on
buildings and offerings. Put something in
there.
I listened to a preacher preach one day. Silver fan on. Blew his nose out the way, and he stopped.
This level.
Yeah.
And God says,
we're going to build this part right. Because we don't have three levels in our church. What do you say, Apostle? I'm not talking about a balcony. The waste was at the bottom. Noah and his family were at the top. The animals were in the middle. God could have put Noah and his family in the middle and the animals at the top. But God said, Noah, I need you at the top. And I want the waste at the bottom. Because if you're going to build it right, you got to separate yourself from the mess. You want to build it right, Noah, you got to separate yourself from mess. And a lot of us, we messed up in our ministry because we all in mess. Trying to preach in mess, trying to sing in mess, trying to usher in mess, and do everything in mess. But God said, I'm calling you to holiness. And when I call you to holiness, God said, I have a long rope, and I'm bringing you out of your mess. I'm bringing you out of your muck and your mire. And truth be told, a lot of us, we look good tonight, but behind closed doors, we're dealing with some secret mess. But God said, as of tonight, I'm bringing you out of it. I'm bringing you out of it. I'm bringing you out of it. The world needs to see that all preachers are phony. There's some real men and real women of God that learn how to separate ourselves from the mess.
So God, if I need to separate myself from the mess, why couldn't I be on the second level? Because there were more animals than there were people. So God said, I don't need to be hanging around people who are dealing with the mess. Be careful who you roll with.
From the beginning. It starts with us. From me all the way to the pulpit, the back door, it starts from us. Are you on a bottle of that? Well, apostle, a real shepherd should smell like sheep. That's right. There's a difference from smelling like sheep and smelling like mess. So in order for us to do it right, we gotta make sure the people could honestly say, I'm looking up at my man of God. I'm looking up at him. They are the epitome of what I'm trying to be like. Trying to get out of my mess. Can all the pastors stand to their feet? Can you stand? I'm done, but can you stand to your feet? Their song tonight. They're on the verge of giving up. On the verge of quitting. They didn't tell you about it, but behind closed doors, I'm ready to throw in the towel. Behind closed doors, I'm looking strong, but I'm just messed up.
So I'm coming here hoping I can get something to change my mindset, to change my thought pattern. Give me hope, God, so I can live again. I can build again. Unlike the man in the beginning of the story, who didn't have a second chance to build again. That house he built, he had to live in. But God said, I'm giving you a second chance. And this time, I'm going to build it the right way. This time, I'm going to build it the right way. You don't have to start from the beginning to start over. Start over where you are right now. To 10 of you, God said, listen, the best is yet to come, even when the worst has already happened. The best is yet to come, even when the worst has already happened. A being in your road is not the end of your road unless you fail to make a turn. Some of you just going through transition. I was talking to apostles earlier. The mistake I made in ministry is I put people in position because they were available. You know, when you need help, you use people who are available. But I had to go through some stuff to realize they weren't gullible or pliable. See, people could have your hand and not have your heart. When someone joined your church, you give them the right hand of fellowship. So they tell you, I can help you out.
The world's way, but I'm coming to you to keep me alive. Some of your own relative of God.
them alive. That's the losing of your life. With all the stuff that you've been. That's why the enemy is trying to get you to quit.
Under attack while you were in church. And God said, no matter what church you go to, no matter what church you pastor, you gonna have to deal with some snakes. Whether you like it or not, you gonna have to deal with some snakes. God, cover me and protect me and give me an anointing to deal with snakes. People who hurt me from the inside. People who mistreat me from the inside. Some of you been hurt by people who you go out to eat with after church. You close to them and they smile in your face the whole time. And yeah, next time. But that's an anointing to deal with that attack from the inside and out. God, so what I'm doing now, I'm taking out all the windows in your field and putting one window. That every leader will see what you see. Wouldn't it be amazed when you go back to church, everybody will see your vision. They're not fighting with it. They're the pastor, whatever you see, I see the same thing. I see it. Pray husband and wife can see the same thing. That where you are, not who you are, God has the power for you to prosper. In the name of Jesus. I pray right now, Father. If you can be bold enough, God, listen. I've been in some mess. I've been drawn to some mess. Help me from my proclivities to even going back to the mess. But I will not go back to who I used to be. In the name of Jesus. Father, we pray tonight for these your people tonight. Maybe you're not a pastor, maybe you just hear it. And the word touch you, I gave you to come to this altar. That God's going to even cause you to float financially. Maybe you're unemployed, but you still paying bills. God's not designed you to float. In the name of Jesus. Father, tonight we pray right now. For every minister right now, every household. We pray right now, Father God, that you will anoint them like you did Noah. To build. I speak right now, Father, in the name of Jesus. Tonight I speak right now, Father. That we're not wasting time building boats. But give us the wisdom on how to build an ark right now, Father. We pray right now, Father God, tonight. Give us strength right now, Father. That no matter what comes our way, Father God, we could float, Father. And the only reason why we can float, Father God, that you would give us strength right now to remain consistent in difficult times. That the same order we have in our house when things are going good, keep that same order in difficult times. If we can preach to hundreds, let us preach to chairs. That we can remain consistent in difficult times. That we can love in difficult times. That we can forgive in difficult times. That in difficult times, though Tina must go on. In the name of Jesus. We must continue in difficult times. That we can flow, Father. Even after the storm, Father. Though Tina is not attached to Panama, but we're attached to you, Jesus. And no matter what venue we have to use, Father, we will fly. Jesus. I pray, apostolically, Father, from the north, the south, the east, and the west, send go for wood, Father. Send leaders that's hard to replace. Send leaders that are around, Father, in the name of Jesus. Send those, Father God, who are not just waterproof, but send me someone who's waterproof, Father. Send me someone that can take up their cross and follow you at the same time. Send me someone that can come to church even if they have to ride a bus, Father. Send me somebody that's waterproof. Send me somebody in the name of Jesus, Father, who's going through some stuff, but they still sing and they still serve. So let me know, Father, they're waterproof. Send them right now, Father. In the name of Jesus. Pray right now, Father, that you would heal them from the hurt on the inside. Heal them, Father God, for how people treated them on the inside. Heal them, Father, how they sterilized their name on the inside. Heal them how they draw them through the mud on the inside, Father. But I pray, Father God, there's a hand of protection around us. That the same joy we have, we keep it. The same anointing that we have, we can keep it. The same peace that we have, we can keep it. We're going to build it the right way. I pray right now, Father, for one window, we can share the same vision. And I pray right now, Father, get us out of this, Father. Purge us with his. Wash us. Make us whiter than snow, Father. Give us the joy of our salvation, Father. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I'll hear from heaven. I'll forgive their sin. Then I'll heal their land. We speak totally healing right now. Thank you. Right now, Father, we ask you to send the people right now. Send the people. Send them, send them, send them. And I pray, Father God, you will give us strength to keep them alive. Whatever you do, Father God, give us wisdom and knowledge to lead your people, that we can keep them alive. Send the prostitutes. Send the drug dealers. Send the whoremongers. Send people the other churches don't want. And give us strength to keep them alive. And I pray right now that as we build it the right way, Father, as we build it the right way this time, Father, when they come in, there's a word that will keep them alive. There will be a worship that will keep them alive. There will be a house that can keep them alive. Hallelujah. 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 Listen, I'm done, but God told me to let you know. Every co-labor, 2018. Here it is. It's the year of results. 2018, you went through a test. And after each test, you get your results. You've been tried. You've been hurt. You've been wounded. You went through a whole lot of stuff. You prayed for some stuff. You saw God on some stuff. And you didn't see anything happen. But God said, this is the year that I'm getting ready to show you your results. This is the year that you will see what you've been praying for. This is the year that you will see what people prophesy over your life. This is the year where you will see the stuff you've been laboring for. This is the year. expecting results. That's the man of God coming. The word I just released. I pray we have the same window. The word I just released. I pray the window that I'm looking out of, you can see that it is the year of results. Can you see? Can you see? Can you see?